Okay, we're starting a new series today. It's going to run through until the middle of January, and it's a first because it's the first time that Warren and I have ever done a series together. So from now until the 19th of January, with the exception of the first Sunday in January when we have a baptismal service, we're doing something a little different that Sunday. All the other Sundays we're following a series through, which we begin today in Luke chapter 1. So you might want to turn to Luke chapter 1 and verse 5. And today's title is Getting Ready for Jesus. Getting Ready for Jesus. So each Sunday from now through until the 19th of January, we'll be following this series through these early chapters of Luke's Gospel. And as I say, it'll be the same whether it's me or Warren, we're going to share together.
The Christmas Story Part 1, Getting Ready for Jesus by Pastor David Wise, is inspired by Luke chapter 1 verses 5 to 25 and 57 to 80. As we look at the events around the birth of Jesus, Elizabeth and Zechariah have given up all hope of God answering their prayers for a child. However, God not only had been listening, his answer was part of a much bigger story. As the congregation look at this passage together, they discover a lot that is relevant to their lives today.
Father God, thank you that you have been with us already this morning as we have celebrated together, prayed together, sung together. Father God, thank you. Thank you that you've been with us as we've had conversation together, as we've talked together. As I wandered around, overheard people talking about what God's been up to in their lives recently. Father God, thank you. Thank you that you're still with us now as we sit and look at your word together. Father God, we ask you to speak to us here. Pray also for Assistant Pastor Warren as he preaches at Haven Green almost at this same moment. Just ask for God's presence, your presence, Father God, with him and the team he's taken with him there as well. So Father God, work among us. We open our minds. We open our hearts. We ask you to speak to us in Jesus' name. Amen. So Christmas is almost here, isn't it? I had a shock. As most of you know, I've been in the States recently. I came back. I was doing something, and I suddenly realised it was sort of like 2 weeks to Christmas. How did that happen? And I went shopping around. Did my food shopping on Friday. And they haven't quite got Easter eggs in Tesco's yet, but you know what I mean. Christmas is well and truly present in absolutely every aisle are well Christmased. So I wonder, and this isn't a question for you to answer out loud. There are some of those, but this isn't one of those. I wonder if you're ready for Christmas. I don't mean if you've got the turkey ordered. Got the wrapping paper, sent the cards, got the present list all done the last minute shopping. It's not last minute yet, so I expect you haven't. I don't mean all of that. I mean, are you ready for Christmas? Because at Christmas, we celebrate the coming into our world of Jesus, the Son of God. And it's an old trite comment, but you know, in the time of Jesus, there was no room for him at the inn. And so often in our busy lives, even us Christians, churchgoers, so often there is no room for him in our lives this time of year. So what we're going to think about this morning is being ready for Jesus. We're going to look at the preparations that God made. We're going to look at his long-term strategy. And we're going to ask some questions about ourselves and our readiness to welcome Jesus into our lives and our activities. So we begin with verse 5 of Luke 1. We're going to the end of the chapter, but we're missing out the middle section. And Warren's going to look at the middle section next week. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah. He belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were upright in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commandments and regulations blamelessly. Sounds good, doesn't it? Next verse begins with the word but. They had no children because Elizabeth was barren and they were both well on in years. Now, as you've listened to this morning, some of you know the story. Those of you that may be not so familiar with the story, there wouldn't have been a huge shock for you. But if you were Jewish at that time, this would have been incredibly shocking. You see, Elizabeth and Zechariah were apparently profoundly blessed by God. Zechariah was a priest by birth. Not only that, he was married to a descendant of Aaron. That's about as blessed as you can get in terms of your parentage, your genealogy. They lived lives together of total dedication to God. They're described as being blameless. But they haven't got children. So what's the issue? Well, the issue is this. Deuteronomy, you don't need to turn to it. Deuteronomy 7 verse 14 talks about the fact that children are a blessing from God. No problem with that. But at that time, people believed the reverse also. That if you didn't have children, it was because God was punishing you. The Bible doesn't say that anywhere, by the way. But that's what was believed at that time. Barren women, women who had never given birth, at that time in that culture, were despised because clearly they were objects of punishment from God. And it was thought that that sort of thing was a bit contagious. So you kept away from people who were being punished by God just in case he missed and hit you instead. You get the principle. It was that sort of idea that was around. And they're old. We don't know how old they were, but they're described as being well on in years. The implication of that is the time for childbearing is past. Their situation, hopeless. Now, I want you to think for a moment. Let's try and imagine. Try and imagine that you are Zechariah, if you're a bloke. If you're a man, put your hand up. Try and get this clear. Okay, you're Zechariah. If you're a woman, put your hand up. You're Elizabeth. Okay, have a think for a moment. Try and spend a few minutes. Some of you are really Elizabeth. That's amazing. Try and think for a moment and feel how they might have felt. Just turn it over in your mind, their situation. Priest, daughter from the line of Aaron. Blameless lives of dedication to God. Childless. How do you think Zechariah, Elizabeth might have been feeling? What do you think? That is a question that I'm looking for answers to. If you're in the teaching for the first time, there are several points that I'm going to stop, ask questions, and look for answers. So if you've got an answer, wave at me, and I will either rush or walk sedately to you with a microphone, depending on how energetic I'm feeling at the moment.
I think they might be feeling like empty lives.
Empty lives.
I think they may feel embarrassed because they're whole and what other people may say about them.
It's like, God, what's happening here?
Very good.
Rejected by God.
Mm-hmm. I just wonder, are there any men in the room, by the way? Any men? Could you just put your hands back up again, just if you're a man? Thank you. I know men are not so good at getting in touch with their feelings and all of that, but give it a go, guys, all right? So like, see a few male hands in a moment. Fantastic.
I'd probably ask myself what I've missed, i.e. what I haven't done that I'm supposed to do, or what I have done that I'm not supposed to do. So I'd go into navel-gazing mode, probably.
Because it's got to be your fault.
It's got to be me, yeah. It's got to be me, so...
I would probably be asking God, what else does he want from me?
Yeah, because you're not quite good enough. What else can you do? What else? Any others, male or female? Any final thoughts or feelings?
Knowing the culture the way I do, I would say that Elizabeth felt deep shame.
Very good observation.
Just in contrast to John's comment, I think, and especially in that society, that Zechariah would have thought, oh, what's she done? He wouldn't look at him. He would think, oh, the woman has done something.
Interesting thought. That's certainly the case in some contemporary, I can't say that it's true of her, but in some contemporary cultures, that certainly would be the case. Okay, let's go on with the story. Verse 8. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshippers were praying outside. Now, there were over 18,000 priests, and they were divided into 24 divisions. Each division was on duty for 2 separate weeks each year. And every day, so that there could be no human favoritism, it was decided by drawing lots who did what. And on this particular day, a particular lot fell to Zechariah. The daily task of greatest honor. And it was considered such a great honor, you were only ever allowed to do it once in your lifetime, was to burn incense on the altar inside the holy place, just outside the Holy of Holies. Now, let me do a little bit of geography for you here. So in the heart and center of the temple is the Holy of Holies. That's where the what's known as the Ark of the Covenant, or the covenant box, was situated. And it was completely covered with a heavy curtain. The poles stuck outside. Once a year, on one day, the high priest only went inside the Holy of Holies. It was the holiest place. Holy of Holies is a form of speech meaning it's the holiest place. And it was there that God's presence was felt to be strongest. Some people talked about the ark as being God's footstool. He sat in heaven, and it's where he rested his feet. It was the place, if you like, where God touched earth. That's why Jews prayed and still pray towards the temple, because that's where God is most present on earth, because that's where his feet are. Just outside of that is the holy place that surrounded it. So for a priest, the closest, unless they're the high priest, the closest they're ever going to get to God's presence is the holy place. This is it. You can't get any closer. Remember, it's a different understanding of the presence of God. We believe today that God's presence is everywhere equally. So you can be Greenford, you can be in Bosnia, as we've talked about this morning. You can be anywhere in the world, God is equally present. You don't point in any particular direction as Christians when you pray, because God is everywhere. But that wasn't the belief at that time. God's presence was located in a specific physical locality. So this was as close to God as you were ever going to get in your lifetime. Notice that the reference in verse 10 here, the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshippers were praying outside. In Luke's gospel, there is this theme that occurs time and again. It's actually teaching us something, as so many of, or all the themes are there to teach. Prayer regularly precedes a revelation from God. You'll see it in Luke, you'll see it in Acts. When people, God's people, come together to pray, often the next thing that happened is God reveals himself. Day of Pentecost, they gathered together in the upper room to pray. And so on and so on, you'll find it all the way through. So here it is, the people here, because there aren't any Christians yet because Jesus hasn't been born. So this is the people of God gathered together, they're praying outside. And he's gone inside. Now, I want you to imagine now, blokes. If you're a man, put your hand up. Just checking, okay. Question for you. What do you think is going on in Zechariah's mind on this day? He's turned up for work at the temple. He's been chosen by lot to go into the holiest place. And he's on his way in. What's he thinking and feeling?
Well, I'm well confused now, because if my initial thought is right, that something is missing and it must be to do with me, then this has come at completely the wrong moment. I've been summoned at completely the wrong time. So if I'm now going to go in the Holy of Holies and I've missed something, then I'm going to fry. So I'm in serious trouble.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And there was, John's hit something very clear here. There was incredible fear. Because, you know, you read through the Old Testament, people that weren't holy, that got too near to God, died. And sometimes not just one or two, sometimes hundreds died. So, yeah, okay. Come on, guys.
I think he would have been amazed that he was chosen to do such a privilege, to go into the holiest of holies, where God is. I think that's amazing.
Okay. Anything else? I see that hand. You're not a guy. Just thought I'd mention that.
Well, this was a once-in-a-lifetime thing for Zechariah, and I'm sure he felt very nervous, and he didn't want to mess up when he was inside there. So I'm not sure, but he probably was very sort of like nervous and confused, but also very privileged. But he also knew it was a once-in-a-lifetime thing that was happening to him.
Yeah. You want to speak for Timmy? Can't Timmy speak for himself? What's your wife going to say, Timmy?
I have no idea.
He's probably thinking, well, have I done to deserve this? Is this a sort of unmerited favor?
Okay. So what I'm hearing, the things we've got some fear. We've got a lot of confusion. I think he was probably, I don't know if he was wearing boots, he's probably wearing sandals. If he was wearing boots, he'd be shaking in his boots. But, you know, he's got sandals on, so it doesn't quite work. But so this is what happens next. So he's gone inside. Verse 11. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He's never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of Israel will he bring back to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Now, just try and imagine yourself here. Ladies, you're allowed to do this now. There's not a question I'm going to ask you to tell me, but I want you to just try and imagine. He's gone inside now the holy place. He's on his own. He cannot be seen by anybody outside. He cannot see anybody outside. He's completely on his own. No one else is allowed in. Just underline the fear thing. When the high priest went in, he went in a special garment with bells on the bottom, so they could hear that he was still alive, just in case God killed him. So he's inside this holy place, right next to the Holy of Holies, where just the other side, he can't see in, he can just see the pole sticking out. That's where God is. That's where God's resting his feet. And he's there. He's there to burn this incense. And he's suddenly aware he's not alone. And not only is he not alone, there's an angel there. Now, we don't know what angels actually look like. The picture in your mind when I say angels has got more to do with medieval art than anything the Bible tells us. So not surprising, he's a bit frightened. Well, actually, I think he was terrified out of his wits. He was frightened going in. And now he's in there, and there's an angel in there with him, and he's on his own. I think absolute terror probably gripped him. Which is why the very first thing that the angel said is, "Do not be afraid." I think he thought he was about to die. This was his last moment on the planet. I don't know that. That's my speculation. The angel says, "Don't be afraid. Your prayer's been heard." I think for a moment he probably thought, "Which one? What? What?" And then the angel, who clearly has got the lowdown on the prayer, says, "Your wife Elizabeth," that's comforting, "Angel knows my family, will bear you a son." What? "And you will call his name John." Now, I reckon Elizabeth and Zechariah had prayed to God a lot of times for a child. I reckon they'd prayed every day, actually, for years. I reckon they'd given up now. You don't pray into hopelessness, do you? But God had been listening. God had been hearing the prayers. Notice how the angel describes, first of all, John bringing pleasure to Elizabeth and Zechariah. And then to many people. And then in the sight of the Lord. There's a couple of other odd things here, just echoes from the Old Testament, which you might not be familiar with. Let me just explain those. There is this requirement for no alcohol. That It's very unusual in those days when it was a normal part with every meal that you drank wine. And in the Old Testament, this not drinking alcohol was associated with being set apart for a special role, for a specific task with God. And there's a parallel here with Samson, because John here is set apart by God even before he is conceived. There's that parallel that is there, and it's a deliberate echo with Luke. Some other echoes as well, because John's mission is set out here to bring Israel to repentance, preparing the way for the Lord to come. And tucked in those words of the angel are a whole lot of echoes from the Old Testament. Here are a few of them. There are just some from the book of Malachi. If you want to turn to it, it's the last book in the Old Testament, or you can just listen. Malachi 2, verse 5 and 6. My covenant was with him, a covenant of life and peace. I gave them to him. This called for reverence, and he revered me and stood in awe of my name. True instruction was in his mouth. Nothing false was found on his lips. He walked with me in peace and uprightness and turned many from sin. Chapter 3 and verse 1, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. Verse 4 of Malachi 3, and the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord as in the days gone by, as in the former years. Chapter 4, verse 5 and 6. See, I will send you the prophet Elijah before that great and dreadful day of the Lord comes. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, or else I will come and strike the land with a curse. So loads, and all of this would have been ringing in Zechariah's ears, because he would have known the Old Testament virtually off heart. So all these references he would have recognized. So here's his response. He asked the angel, how can I be sure of this? I'm an old man and my wife is well on in years. What he's asking here is for a sign. You know, all very well, angel, you know, the fact you've turned up, you've got in here somehow, supernatural, you know all about my prayers, my family. Yeah, I get all of that. About a sign? Angel appearing, knowing all about family and prayers, sort of a sign already, really. But it wasn't enough. So he asked for a sign. He got something he didn't quite bargain for. Not quite what he expected. The angel answered, and it sounds a little bit like the angel was just a little bit peeved. Just very slightly peeved, having made this journey from heaven all the way down here to talk to Zechariah and have said all this to him. And Zechariah says, oh, how do I know this is true? I mean, it does strike you as being, I mean, I understand where he's coming from, but with hindsight, not the best response. Angel says, I can see him pulling himself up to his full, whatever, you know, 7-8 foot. Don't know quite how high angels are. I'm speculating here, but the fact that people are frightened of them, I think they're bigger than me. Do you know what I mean? I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God. I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you the good news. Does sound slightly peeved, doesn't he? And now, just so you know, you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their proper time. Well, you know, I'm with Zechariah on one level. You know, perhaps I've been a bit hard on him. He was having a difficult day. You know, going to do a job, greatest privilege of a lifetime, big angel turning up, talking to him. But as I say, he got slightly more than he bargained for. There's another echo here, of course, of Abraham. Similar echo, Abraham. Very similar parallel there. Meanwhile, out in the rest of the world, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized he'd seen a vision in the temple. I think perhaps a bit of waving of arms was going on when he came out. For he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. I know quite what the sign is, for I've seen a big angel. But, you know, I think he was probably working on making it up. See, the thing was, he was supposed to be in and out quite quickly. He wasn't supposed to be hanging around. He was supposed to be in and out as soon as he'd done what he was there to do. And when he came out, part of his job, that he was supposed to pronounce a blessing over the people waiting outside, which of course he can't do. And so they're all waiting for their blessing, and he can't speak. Much waving of arms as he tried to make signs. We could have a competition, couldn't we? You think? See if we could see how many of the guys here could communicate. I've seen a big angel. He's told me my wife's going to have a baby. See how you get on with it. No, it's all right. Let's move on. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. The Lord has done this for me, she said. In those days he's shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people. That's a really strong word. Going back to how we talked earlier on about how she felt, God has taken away my disgrace among the people. The Lord has done this for me. Okay, we're going to drop down to verse 57. Next week, Warren's going to look at verses 26 through to 56. We're going to pick up the story in verse 57. When it came time for Elizabeth to have her baby, she gave birth to a son. Her relatives and neighbors heard that the Lord had shown her great mercy, and they shared her joy. Showed her great mercy, that's about the fact that God has shown that she wasn't under his judgment. I mean, she wasn't anyway, we know that. But what he'd done was a demonstration to the people around that she was not under his judgment. And she takes a position of honour in the community, particularly, of course, in that culture, giving birth to a boy. Extra special bonus there. Sorry, ladies, I don't agree with it. That was what was believed in the culture at the time. Verse 59. On the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child, and they were going to name him after his father, Zechariah. But his mother spoke up and said, "No, he is to be called John." They said to her, "There is no one among your relatives who has that name." Then they made signs to the father. Remember, he's deaf and dumb. To find out what he would like to name the child. He asked for a writing tablet. To everyone's astonishment, he wrote, "His name is John." Immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue was loosed and he began to speak, praising God. All the neighbors were filled with awe, and throughout the hill country of Judea, people were talking about all these things. Everyone who heard this wondered about it, asking, "What then is this child going to be?" For the Lord's hand was with him. Just an interesting aside here. Some of you come from families where there are cultural traditions. And sometimes those cultural traditions are cut across by God's will and purpose. So here there's a cultural tradition. He should be called Zechariah. Well, that's his dad's name. Or at least someone else from the family. God cuts across that. It can create a huge family row in some families. But for us as Christians, with those cultural traditions, they're not wrong in themselves. But when they cut across what God is saying or what God is doing, it's important to put God's word in place and doing what he wants. So next time there's one of those rows, it may not be over the naming of a baby, but it could be over all sorts of things. You think, actually, what is God's will here? And it may be there's nothing wrong with the cultural tradition, or it may be that God has something different in mind. Okay, I've got the second of my three questions I've got for you this morning. So far, now, we started off thinking about Elizabeth and Zechariah right at the beginning of the story. What lessons do you think we can learn so far for ourselves? Now, you know, none of us here are priests, but the principles here, some of these things apply very much to us today. So what do you think? What are some of the lessons that we can take away from the passage so far before we come into the last part? And ladies, you can participate as well as men.
I think the thing that hits me, David, still thinking as Zechariah, is that his answer to the angel is governed by how he sees himself. So he's kind of saying, this can't be right because I'm missing something. So you must have got it wrong. And it's because he's navel-gazing and thinking inwardly. And so often we're caught in the small picture of something. And actually there's a massive big picture happening here, which we miss because we're in the small picture. And really, it's not been about Elizabeth being barren or him being wrong. It's about God's doing something big. And we lose that because we're dominated by our own feelings about ourselves.
It's a very, very profound point. Many years ago, I took a non-Christian to a particular meeting, healing meeting. And this person was an atheist, didn't believe in God at all. And in front of our faces, there were miracles taking place. Obvious to me. But they had a particular perspective about themselves and how the world was. And they actually couldn't see what was taking place 2 or 3 meters away from them. And that's an extreme example, but here, you're right. Angels come inside the Holy of Holies, special day. But he doesn't get it because he's so focused on himself. His eyes aren't open to the bigger picture. Very important lesson for us. Thank you. I saw some other hands, quite a few other hands down the middle. So let's go and wander down there.
So far what we've read, I think it just summons that God makes things beautiful in his own time.
When God has a plan, like in this instance, he had a grand plan, a grand
something massive he had in place or planning to happen, and he had a strategy in terms of how he was going to make it happen. And the strategy started with the barrenness of Elizabeth and Zechariah's visit to the temple, and he was visited by an not just an angel, not just an ordinary angel, but one of the archangel. Gabriel is a massive, is a big angel. He's the same guy that visited Mary to announce that she will be pregnant. And eventually, Elizabeth became pregnant. So it goes to show there is God had a plan for that to happen. He had a plan for John as the forerunner of Jesus, something I believe Warren will talk about next week. So he had the plan in sequence. And the lesson here is that when we are going through challenging times in our lives, hard as it may be, we possibly need to appreciate that maybe God has a plan. God has a plan and a strategy. Something will come out of this. How it will come out, we don't know, but we just have to rely on the fact that delay does not mean denial. He will make things perfect, like Hannah said, in his own time.
Very good. And alongside that, you know, they are looking at the situation of not having a child, and they're interpreting it from a particular perspective. But they have got no idea what God is up to. And sometimes we can look at our lives, something that happens to us, and we think, oh, this must be. But actually, we're not seeing it from God's perspective. Not seeing the bigger picture.
Yeah, I believe that when we pray, God is quiet. It's like we're asking, God, where are you? But God really is listening. But he have his own time when he's going to intervene. So that is why Jesus said, pray without ceasing. Because when God is quiet, like nothing is happening, it doesn't mean that he's not doing anything. He's doing something on our behalf, behind the scene, that we cannot see. So therefore, when God is quiet, it doesn't mean that he's not listening or nothing is happening. And we need to bear that in mind. When God is quiet, it doesn't mean that he's not doing anything.
God always hears our prayers. Come now to the real Elizabeth.
It just strikes me that sometimes our culture can be stronger in our influencing than what God's saying and doing.
Looking at Zechariah's situation, one would think that he was past it, but I think it teaches us that we should always expect the unexpected. So.
Yeah. Okay, last one.
Following on from what Timmy said, Zechariah was probably past it. He was an old man. From a human point of view, he might have been too old to father a child, and so the same with Elizabeth. But we must remember that nothing is impossible with God.
Amen. Amen. Okay, let's move on to this last part, Zechariah's song. And it comes in two parts. The first part is backward-looking, and the second part is forward-looking. The backward-looking bit, which I'm going to read in a moment, is actually there is a lesson here. You see, what John is going to be can really only be understood. There's a guy called Joel Green wrote this. What John will become can only be appreciated against the backdrop of what God has been doing. You've got to see it in the context of what God is up to. His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come and has redeemed his people. He's raised up a horn of salvation, I'll come back to that in a moment, for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets of long ago. Salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hands of our enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. It's So there are two main themes in this first part. These reasons, this is all a benediction, giving lots of reasons for praising God. The first thing is praising God for coming to his people. That God hasn't forgotten about them. God's never forgotten. They've never been out of God's sight. So there is that theme that is there. The second theme is about God bringing a saviour from the line of David. That phrase horn there, horn is a symbol of strength. So that is the other theme that is there. So God constantly coming to his people, God raising up a saviour. So looking back, well, that's the context, and this is the future. And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High. For you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven, to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace. And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he lived in the desert until he appeared publicly to Israel. So this second part is about John preparing the way for Jesus. So let's think about Zechariah's song for a moment. And here's my third and last question for you this morning. As we here now, at the end of 2013, here in West London, as we prepare for Christmas, what can we learn from Zechariah's song that helps us prepare for Christmas? Thinking going on now.
When we encounter God, to praise him.
Say that again.
When we encounter God, to praise him.
What else?
That we should hope, and as in hope, that it's definitely that Christ has come. He has been born to give us life.
I saw a hand over here. There we go.
God is a faithful God which never fails us. What he say he will do, he will do.
What else? I'm glad the hands are going up while I'm at the back.
That nothing's impossible for God if you just trust in it.
Very good.
We also need to shine in the darkness. We need to be a light for the rest of the world so that they know what it's really, really about.
Anything else? Going to sneak through this row. So.
Just as Zechariah and then his son John's life was focused towards Jesus, in all the busyness of this time, our main focus needs to be on him, and that hopefully will affect other people too.
Very good. That was one of the things as I reflected on this this song. One of the themes here is about hearts being prepared for the Word of God. And as I was saying right at the beginning, it's so easy for us in this busy time of year with all the different things we're trying to give attention to, for the space for God's word coming into our heart afresh in this season, there not being enough space for it because it's filled of all sorts of stuff. I think also it reminds us that Christmas is actually about salvation. It's not about Christmas trees, not about presents. I'm not opposed to Christmas trees, not opposed to presents. Quite like presents, actually. But actually, it is about salvation. It's about Jesus coming into our world. So as we think back over this whole passage this morning, I just want to pull out a few things, and then I'm going to pray for us as we draw to a close. You know, there's a reminder in here, which is a very powerful reminder for some of you in the congregation, for some of you who are watching this on the internet, that God hears our prayers, even when it doesn't feel like it, even when it doesn't look like it, even when we think the time for answer has passed. God hears our prayers. God hears your prayers. God has heard them. God goes on hearing them. And in the meantime, you see, Zechariah and Elizabeth could have thought, stuff this. I spent all this time serving God, living blameless lives. And what have I got to show for it? But they didn't. They continued living blameless lives before God. So in the meantime, whilst they're waiting for answers to those prayers, they continued to serve him. It reminds us also that God works on a long time scale. You know, long time for some of us is 5 minutes. God works on a big time scale. A long time scale. He planned to make it possible for every person in our world to find forgiveness and reconciliation with him. So this Christmas, Jesus is on the agenda. So in our families, at our school events, our work events, lots of opportunities to talk about the real significant meaning of Jesus. Just coming back into my mind, I don't know why it's just appeared, so I will just tell you the story. When I, many, many years ago, I worked as a milkman, delivering milk in Southall. First job I did after we got married. And I had a nickname. I had very long hair in those days. I looked a little bit like a Yeti. And a big beard out here. And everyone in the depot called me Jesus. Because I wasn't shy about talking about my Christian faith. So they all called me Jesus. Well, this year, we'd done something particularly well as a depot. It wasn't the first year. It was the second Christmas I was there. And the company put up some money which we could choose what to go with. So the guys decided, nearly all guys, one girl working there, that they'd go to a nightclub in Watford, I think it was. I forget, it's probably closed down now. So off we go. I decided, well, I'm going to go along to this. You know, I don't think I'd ever been to a nightclub before, so I went off to this nightclub in Watford. What did I spend about a third of the evening doing? Sitting at a table telling someone about Jesus. Because they came along and they said, can I ask you some questions? Yeah, sure. I spent a third of the evening sitting at his table with this guy, sharing with him my testimony, my experience of God, and why actually Christmas really mattered. Let's take those opportunities as they surround us this year, at work, parties, all sorts of places. There are people that need to know reconciliation with God and to find forgiveness. Let's stand together. I'm going to give you a moment of quiet to make your own response to God, and then I'm going to pray for us as we come to an end this morning. Father God, thank you for Jesus coming into our world. Thank you you planned this on a long time scale. You brought all the parts together. Thank you for the way that you met Zechariah and Elizabeth at their point of need. Thank you for the way that you blessed them as a part of that preparation. Father God, we pray for ourselves as we approach Christmas. Help us to be people who are open to your word, even in unexpected places. Open to receiving your word, opening to sharing your word with people around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.